keep to share with people who come so they can know more about the people we're here. Since my birth back in 1927, if any of you heard the key to the code to the gate, when my grandson, this is my son, Bill Campbell. He's recently retired from being the county attorney for 28 years. I said, boy, when you have a kid that's retired after he's had a law practice and been county attorney for 28 years, you know you've been around the block a few times.
Once or twice.
I could not. But anyway, he has two sons who have taken a great interest in this place. And one is an attorney in Houston, and one is in the service. And Bill, has he been in the service 17 years?
Getting close to that.
And so Bill knows he's been around the block a while if he's got a kid that's been in the service for 17 years. So we'll have to... We will include him in the Elders Council, okay? Yes. I'll be the elder, since I was born in 1927. I guess, was anybody born before 1927? Now, I had a funny, what is your time limit, Mr. Bus Driver or Mrs.? Linda, what's the time, when do they have to leave?
We have all day.
Yeah.
All right, there are some chairs up here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you made it back, yeah. Yes. I am such a long-winded speaker, Bill knows. I was a teacher and he actually attended some of my classes when he was in middle school and high school. And sometimes I would be so excited about what I was trying to teach those kids that I wouldn't hear the bell. And the math teacher would come banging on the door and say, Mrs. Campbell, did you know that those young people need to learn something besides what you've got to say? So there's not anybody to be on the, except Linda. Well, Bill and Linda can really be in charge because they are very scholarly. And I forgot to tell you I was the art teacher. So they thought that wasn't very important, the math and the chemistry and all the people that were banging on my door to let those people go. Let my people go! Because they'd rather be in the art class, right? But anyway, you don't have anybody to come and free you, so Linda can say, oh, we had an appointment with our manicurist in 15 minutes, we have to leave. So you make up some excuse why you have to leave. But we're going to go down to the pictograph site, and this afternoon, as Bill just informed me a while ago, his wife said that the wind is going to blow 25 miles an hour this afternoon, and it's going to be blowing from a real bad direction, so some of you may want to just stay on the bus. But anyway, we will go and have a little walk down there. It's a very easy walk. If someone who was born in 1927 can walk along, you know it's an easy walk. So, but it's going to be so windy that you may feel like you're blowing down. So, anyway.
Could we park a little close? How close can we park for the people that can't walk a long way? Like,
well, they're not going to walk a long ways, and we will send somebody back to the to get a car to pick up the people that can't walk. Yeah, it's not any problem. In fact, the bus can drive along if it has to, but it might be better if a car did, you know, for the bus, not for us, because great big old tour buses with 50 people drive down. They'll let everybody walk to the end of the trail. My husband says it's about like walking 3 city blocks. If you were shopping in downtown Austin, it would be like going 3 city blocks. So it's not a long walk. And it's perfectly level. It's not up and down. You're not going to have to climb. Okay. And the reason that Bill and I get to be here is because, and actually Linda, because if we hadn't been here, well, Linda wouldn't be here either, would she? All of you know all these folks. Is that right?
Many autumns.
Linda has been our friend since the first bunch of our Comanche friends came here 25 years ago, she said. Are you the one that told me there, or was it?
Yeah, I think it was my...
Do any of you know Joe Vickers?
Yes.
She's a descendant of Asa Hobby. And she's the one that found us down here 25 years ago. You need... Didn't she know Joe Vickers? Anyway, she called me one day and said that her name was Joe Vickers and she wanted to come take pictures of the pictographs. And I said, well, you certainly may. I always want everybody to take pictures. And so she said, when could she come? And I made an appointment. She came down. And when she got here, I took her down there and she started telling me how she got interested. And she was a Comanche native. And her great, and I don't know whether great-great or great-great-great, grandfather was Asa Hobby. And that she had been informed and had read in a book that her grandfather had made a series of stars down here. And she had a picture, and I was able to take her down there, and she took pictures. And anyway, when she stayed with us in our house and stayed 2 or 3 days and took lots of pictures, and we became really good friends in those days. And my husband was invited up to Oklahoma City to make a speech about woolen mohair to some kind of a convention up there. And talking to her on the phone, I told her, oh, I'm coming up to Oklahoma, City. She said, well, just come by Lawton, and I'll introduce you to some of my Comanche friends. And she had us come down to Lawton, and she had a Thanksgiving dinner for us. And she had Doc Tate and Leonard
Gribbles?
Black Moon. And Wallace Coffee, and just a whole bunch of, I imagine there were 20 there, Comanches that we met. And we got to be such good friends. And they said, well, they never had been to Texas. This was 25 years ago. And we said, we need to come. So we invited them. And that's when the first time you came was when they came down. Do you remember the date? You said it was about 25 years ago.
I think it was in 1992, but I don't even remember the month.
I don't either,
but
it must have been.
It was pretty cool.
It was cool, and there was a big fire.
It was pleasant weather. Because I remember that, you know, we had a man cook a beef or something down there, and Mr. Bowman, he cooked for us while we went down and visited down there. But anyway, we had become really good friends with a lot of the Comanches that now have gone on up to their home in the sky, and we're just glad to see that you all are continuing your interest in these places where your ancestors came and found experiences that were very meaningful to them, and they recorded it on the rocks. And now there are many pictograph sites in the world, all over the world. My husband did work all over the world, and sometimes if I was on good behavior in the summertime when I wasn't teaching, I got to go along. And we have seen pictographs in many parts of the earth. But, you know, when you get home and you say, my goodness, here I have been living with the bluebird of happiness all these years and didn't even realize it. And so I'm glad you've come to see our bluebird today. And it's not really ours, it belongs to eternity, because the people came here and felt the spirituality in this place and wanted to mark and maybe just record some of their feelings. And since they hadn't had good schools to go to, like all of you, and Bill didn't have such a good school because he had me for a teacher, but anyway, some of the places he went, he had good school. Or he wouldn't have been a lawyer, huh? But anyway, these people had to kind of make up their own way of communicating their thoughts, and that's what I think these are. And one of the most interesting things about this pictograph site, as I compare it to others that we've seen in different parts of the world, is that there are many different styles of painting. And that after you look at them for 90 years, you begin to see that better, especially since I went off to college and majored in art history, and I became interested in style. And that is, but one thing almost all of them have in common all over the world, that the natives who made them had discovered some permanent pigments. And almost all of them used some ores. And iron ore seems to be the most permanent of all of them, because you will see, even though you see other colors besides red, the most vivid ones you see will be red. And so one of the good things about this place, iron ore is found all over the world. And you noticed our town is named Paint Rock. Didn't she expect to have see big hills with red rocks on them? We don't have any paint rock in Paint Rock except the marks that the Indians left down here. Because we don't have a natural deposit of iron ore here in this place. They had to bring it with them. And that's one of the ways you can trace the places where these painters got their pigments. Each red rock that was found down here at a level where they were probably using it to make paint, each one will have a little different composition. And you can trace it back to the place from whence it came. And that's one of the things I think that's interesting. Now this, and the reason they leave them here, this is a piece of hematite. And it came, you can pass it around and check, see if you'd like to carry that in your backpack.
Oh my goodness.
You know, our friends that came here a long time before, the ones that we even have named, were walking, carrying everything they owned. And sometimes they would walk, I'm told they would walk for 18 hours carrying their things in a natural fiber backpack. And this is the way they moved along. And that's why it's easy to, easy to find material that they left in here. Because this happened to be a place they liked to come a lot. And so what if you got that rock from passing around in your backpack and you know you're going to want to use it next time you come? What are you going to do with that rock? You're going to stick it up under a place where you can maybe you can find a painting and find it. And so my husband had been a really tireless researcher, and he goes down and looks under the shelves and back underneath and finds things that they left. And archaeologists like to leave them here so people who come to do research will find them. And often people just leave them at the place where they find them. But because some people may not have the time, they bring them up here and we keep them, and that's why we have these. But that piece of hematite was brought here just a few years ago from a place that the hematite for some of these paintings was found. And the way they found it, one of our nice professors, Dr. Dawkins, who was a chemistry professor up at ASU, took our little rock that Fred found that obviously had been used by a, I'm turning the wrong direction. This is one of them. See, this rock was found down there. And see how it looks different. But it's got the rough sides that you can see it's been ground off. And this was left here by a Native American painter. And he would leave these things in places where he could find them, as I said, to use the next time he came. Mm-hmm. And so when Dr. Dawkins asked permission to take one of this rock, this is one, this rock, up to his office and see if he could find out the origin of it, because every deposit of this rock will have something different in it. You know, it's not pure. And so he was able to analyze it, and he found out it came from a place between 60 and 100 miles from here. And so he told us where we could go to find some just like it. And we went down there, and that, the rock you're passing around, is one that we found on our 50th wedding anniversary. And we've been married 67 years, so you know how long we've had that rock. But that rock is the same composition as this rock that some Native American painter brought here X number of years ago. And it's hard to tell exactly when it came. I have maybe some symptoms or some clues, but you can't be sure because other people have handled it.
Is that all hematite?
This is hematite. This is iron rock.
And the other one?
Uh-huh. See, this is the same rock as that rock. See how heavy this is? I'm not going to pass that around because
it's a different composition. James River.
From the James River down south of Mason, southeast of Mason. No, west of Mason. We don't need to pass that one around. It's just like the other one, except you can see where the Indians scraped up their pigment. And this one. And see, this is another interesting thing. This is a paint pot that was found down there. It's just a river rock that had a natural cavity, and they reamed it out, and they ground some places for their fingers to fit so it wouldn't fall out of their greasy hand, because they had to have something to make it waterproof. So they mixed it with animal fat, and they would put their ground up hematite and their animal fat, and sometimes they throw in some other things for ceremonial uses, and they mix it up, and then they had a nice little paint pot. And this one, there are some researchers who believe these two rocks were used together. They were found near each other. And in fact, they were found down near, we can really make a good story. See, that's the good thing about a place like this. Whatever you believe, and I've told you all my life, my grandpa introduced me to all these people that told me all these stories. And sometimes I have three or four different stories about the same thing. The stories don't match. So do you know how you can tell the difference? Everybody listen. This is the way you tell the difference. If you like the person telling the story, that's the one you believe. That's where when Linda tells me something, I believe Okay, anyway, this is a rock that would have looked very much like that one that you passed around when he first started. He started grinding on it until he could use it with his little paint pot. And he'd fill that through with his powder, as I am about to do. I'm not going to put it in here because that would contaminate my artifact. But here I've got... this is one that we found on that same day when we went down on our anniversary to find the rock. And it was just a rough piece of rock. And I've been grinding on it, and Bill has, and whoever comes up here to help people go to the pictograph site so they'll find them. They grind on it. And see, it's changed shape. We've ground it off. And so that's what I'm going to do right now. I'm going to grind some, and I'm going to make a painting on my arm. Now, you will remember, I just said that they didn't have a school to go to learn to write alphabet. In fact, think about if you had been walking 18 hours trying to find stuff to keep your family alive, would you go home with the few remaining hours you had to rest and write an alphabet and start writing history books? No, you'd try to rest so you could get up and do the same thing tomorrow. So that's why... One time somebody said, well, they weren't very smart just to draw those little old pictures. I said, now wait a minute. Take off your $500 shoes and anyway, try working 18 hours. And most people complain if they have to work 8 hours. And I just said, go home then and write a history book after you've done all those things. And so you have to remember that anything they did was just an inspiration. And so right now I'm going to show you how they made their paint. And they would have mixed it just probably in natural... Some of them would have used... This is a These are Concho mussel shells, Concho River mussel shell. That's one of the reasons they like to come to Paint Rock, because we have a really good supply of mollusks that they ate these mussels, and they found little pearls in them and made jewelry, and then they'd use them for, you know, vessels, and they would use them for paint pots. Mm-hmm. And so they would have had other things, and just because I'm doing it one way doesn't mean this is the only way it was ever done. Okay. Now, I am going to make a pictograph, and you're going to see how, if you didn't know how to write alphabet words, you could make something that would make an impression on someone. They would have an idea about what you were trying to tell them. Okay. Now, you see, I'm changing that from a solid to a powder. And I'm going to add some water instead of, this is bear fat, and it's really nice and smooth and makes really good paint. I have painted with it. In fact, I made this paint to paint one of our buffalo guys. And I made this paint out of what I'm doing, only I mixed it with bear fat. And I did that, I guess, about the time we went down and got our rocks. So it will last, and this would have lasted if we'd left it outside. Mm-hmm. Now, this one made by a Native American. I always mm-hmm. thought I was a Native American until I became just this wrong when they told me that my grandparents, I think back in the, before the Revolutionary War, I think they all got kicked out of England for being something that they weren't supposed to be doing or something. I'm not sure. I'm not sure how we got here, but anyway, we stayed up there for a good while and we didn't get to come down and mingle. So I don't get to be like y'all and be Native American. I think I'm a Native American. I was born here in Paint Rock. Well, actually, Ballinger. The y'all were across from the hospital. The hospital's moved since I was born, twice. But Mother had to go over to Ballinger to the hospital. Paint Rock did not have a hospital, but anyway.
What kind of bone is it?
It's a buffalo bone. One of our buffalo died, and Fred let me paint. Didn't I give y'all one, Bill? Didn't I give you one of my buffalo bones I painted? I tried to give them to very special people. Okay. Because the first paintings that my grandfather ever saw when he came to Texas back in 1876, the first ones he saw were on buffalo bones. At watering places. Is Linda back there? Linda, I was going to pass this along. I want Linda to, when she, is she? Okay, look, she's probably talking to me. That's okay. Anyway, I want her to have one of those books with the deer on the front. I have little children's books that I write. And y'all see that book? Would you get one with the deer on the front and pass it over? And Bill, when she comes in, tell her that's the one I wanted her to read.
Where do you get your bear grease?
Well, yeah, this is my smart aid. Don't throw a tomato at me. Dead bear.
Good answer.
You know, I don't know why I don't have a job on television. I stand up for me. There's your book that I was. You said you haven't read that book?
I don't have this one.
Well, that's the one that is the one you should have. Yes, well, of course, I've got some others, but anyway. Anyway, one of my great nephew who lived in Georgia, still lives in Georgia, when he was 10 years old, he's a little mountain guy, they said, John, what do you want to do for your 10th birthday? He said, I want to go up to North Carolina and kill a bear so Aunt Kay can have some real bear grease to make real Indian. So that was, John is 17 now, so 7 years ago, John killed the bear and sent me that whole jug, and I've used it. It makes real good paint. So this was made with bear grease and hematite. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I still haven't made my paint on my arm, but I'm making it with water instead of bear grease. And I'll hold it up after I get my act going here. Now, just because I do it this way doesn't mean that every Native American that made paint did it the same way. It would have, there would have been, you know, it's what you do with what you got. If you saw something that had rubbed some powder up on this and you rubbed two of these rocks together, you might make paint. Or if you, there would be all kinds of ways that you would have the idea that you could make paint out of this. And now I am going to make a painting on my arm. Keep it off of my pretty shirt that Judy and Bill gave me. See, I'm making a pretty good bunch of paint here. This is why barns are painted red. The first people up in the Northeast that came from being kicked out of England were cutting down trees and making barns, and they wanted their barns to last, and so they put bear grease on them. And then, if they wanted to continue painting, they wouldn't know where they'd stop, and it was so much trouble. One of the Indian friends said, here, take some of this rock and grind it up in your paint, and you will have a clue when you see the red, you'll know that you've already painted there. And so then in the next generations, when they didn't have to do that anymore, they didn't know, they just thought you were supposed to paint. Now can everybody see what I'm doing? Okay. Now I'm going to make a symbol on my arm, and you're going to tell me what it is. I have such so many wrinkles in my arm, it may change it into something else. That happens. Okay, see, what did I write on my arm?
Was that a running man?
Somebody said man. Y'all are too timid. Didn't it look like a man?
Yeah, it's a man. Yeah.
All right. You know, when you're showing this to little children, some of them give you different answers. One time a little kid said, it's my mommy. Anyway, whatever. That's why you don't want to give up reading and writing, because it does not, the picture doesn't always tell you, as you're going to see if I'll ever quit talking. Bill, do you have your BB gun to shoot me in the head?
I don't own a BB gun.
Okay, well, yes.
Oh, yeah.
My arm has been on national television. Wrinkles and all.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, now there is one more paint pot I wanted to show you, and another artifact up here that I like very much. This is a little paint pot that was made from a small geode. They just made a hole in the hard outer crust of the geode and then got a sharp piece of flint and cleaned the crystals out. And I'll pass this around, and you can feel that. And you look, they made black paint. There were minerals that they could use to make red and yellow, black and white. Does that mean anything? Some Comanches have those four colors for their four sacred colors. Red for the heat from the south, white for the cold from the north, yellow for the sunrise in the east, and black for the sunset in the west. And anyway, they did have four colors. And they're all represented down here, but the main ones you're going to see are going to be red. But y'all can pass that one around. See, the way you can tell that was used for something just besides being an accident, see, this is the color that would have been. And they used it with their stained, greasy hand until it got polished just like a piece of furniture would. See, it would have looked like this before it was used. Okay, now this is some of the reasons that they chose Paint Rock as a special place. Number one was water, and that's the little children's book that I wrote about. It's about how wildlife found the water and made trails for the Indians to follow, and the Indians made trails for the white folks to follow, and the white folks made trails for the engineers to follow when they were making their highways. And it explains this to little six-year-old kids in my little book. But we have lots of little children that come here, and some of the things that we say we don't realize, they don't understand everything we're talking about. Well, this, another reason they like to come to Paint Rock, because besides the water, is the flint. We have a mountain of Edwards Plateau flint, which is wonderful for napping. You see examples in the frames of artifacts that have been found here. And this is my favorite one. My husband found this down at the site, hidden. See, it's heavy. You don't want to take it with you. And so you store it here. And it's a club. And Dr. Frankie Beth Nelson, who was my hero in the world of explaining things to me when I needed lots more explaining than she could do, but she told me some of the uses for this multi-purpose tool. It would compare to a Swiss Army knife or a Leatherman tool that we would have, and this was the forerunner of those multi-purpose tools that we have in our work boxes today, toolboxes. See, this now, they have shaped it with places for handholds, and it's a nicely balanced club. And she said it was most likely used after a buffalo run. They would run the buffalo off, and if they weren't totally dead, they would take it, a club, and they knew where to hit them. Where do you have to hit it? I know you hit them in the head, that didn't bother them because they hit each other in the head so hard, but they had to know where to hit him to do him in so he wouldn't do the cooks in when they came to get the meat. So this is a club that was probably used for that purpose. All right, now after the feast, you're going to need some drying racks to make jerky. So you need a post hole digger. So you just take your big rock and you take some pieces off and turn it into a post hole digger. See how nicely you can hold it? Okay, and then as the jerky is drying, you want to break the bones open to get the bone marrow. Bone marrow is still important. It's used for sick people for curing some diseases. And the Indians found lots of uses for bone marrow, which you can research on. You can Google it up when you get home. Find out. I won't have to try to remember the name of them all. But you see, this becomes a hand axe that you could break the bones open. And if you'd like to, you may. I think this is such a cool tool. And Dr. Frankie Beth could show you numerous ways that you could use that tool. And because there are great big nodules up here, when they were here having ceremonies, they would go up and get flint and make tools to replenish. Okay. Now the other thing that I think is interesting, they needed, and this is another thing. See, all along the river there are layers of limestone, and they made holes where they could grind up feet. That's my husband with his hand down in a mortar hole, so you can see. And then this is yucca fiber. The yucca fiber is very good and very strong. I used to let people take it in and try it, but one time there were some football players from a university down here that had been sent down to get enough credit so they could play football the next week. And they broke my rope, so I don't let you do that anymore. But it's very strong. But they would weave their backpacks and their shoes and whatever out of yucca fiber, and there are many plants out there growing right now that would make wonderful fibers for making baskets. Okay, now I'm going to just very quickly show you a few pictures. This is something you might like to look at. This is an aerial photo of the site. The bluff, which was caused by a separation in the the limestone deposit, and a movement of the earth caused it to separate. And what made this such a special place was that the south part sank and pushed the north part up 70 feet. So when a north wind blows, you can get up under that shelter and you don't feel it. And yesterday that would work. Today it's a south, but it won't be cold or uncomfortable, but it won't show that. But anyway, in the summertime, the sun, the direction of the sunlight is from the north, and so you can get up under these shelves and you have shade. And then there's a nice alluvial deposit that has developed here from the overflowing water from the river. And the river stays fresh and pure because we have springs that keep running into it, making it fresh. And so you've got your water, and then along the bluff, along the edge of the stream, there are pecan trees, which not only feed people, but also wildlife. So it made honey, and you had your water, and then of course, it was full of edible mollusks. And then they had their flint supply. So if you wanna pass that around and look at it, I think that's kinda interesting. Now we're gonna look at a few of the pictures. Now, I love the word conjecture, and since I was an old teacher, conjecture just means whatever you think. You're responsible for the meaning of your conjecture. So I think, and there are a lot of people who are very, very intelligent people who think they can read stories and things in this, and I'm sure that some of them probably get them right. It'd be almost accidental, since there were many people for many years. Archaeologists had found evidence that there were people camping down here by this river for over 12,000 years. Periodically, they did not stay here all the time, and not all of them would have painted. Mm-hmm. And it's very difficult to get a good dating on a painting, because in order to get a dating, you have to remove the paint from the rock and date the organic matter, which would be minute by this time. And sometimes they'd paint on top of other people's paintings, and so the information would be garbled. So it's very difficult, unless you have some realistic subject matter to use to help you with the dating. And sometimes the realistic subject matter is, it will throw you off because maybe they did it after the fact, you see. So anyway, I'm gonna show you some pictures. Now that I've told you nobody knows what they are, I'm gonna tell you exactly what they are, okay? I'm very credible. Now, one of the most interesting paintings down here is a painting of a turtle. And see, it's not even going to look like a turtle to everybody, but after I tell you it's a turtle, right? Mm-hmm. I don't remember my little turtle I have, but... Okay, in the center of the shield, see, there's the head of the turtle, and there is legs, and there is a myth that the turtle was so patient, the Indians honored him by letting him carry the sun to rest 2 days, the first of winter and the first of summer. They called the beginning of summer and the beginning of winter the time of the turtle, when the sun walks slowly, resting on the back of the most patient of animals, the turtle. And on the first day of winter and the first day of summer, at exactly midday, which is 12:37 plus a few seconds here at Paint Rock, there will be a little line of light that will come down and make a dagger that touches the sun on the back of the turtle. And see, that's an entirely different story that my grandfather would have told you. And he's the one that came down here doing research. And he bought this place because people were ruining the pictographs. And he said that's the best evidence I've had about how the people lived and what they did. And people who do not understand that are ruining it. People are coming here to camp for the same reason that the Indians came. And that's what I bring out in my little book I write for kids so they'll know that all people need the same things. We need shelter, food, and water. And it doesn't matter whether you're pink with purple polka dots or how you are, you're still, if you're a human, you're going to need shelter and water. And that's what these people found here. But here is the turtle with the sun on his back and the sun dagger. Today you won't see the sun dagger because it just comes on 2 times a year, on the first of winter and the first of summer. So it is very bright because it's under a shelter. Y'all want to pass around? Some of the people in the back might have trouble seeing it. Okay, there are several solar markers down here. And to me, that is so fascinating to think about these people who hadn't had science class were able to go down there and figure out the when the first day of summer was and when midday was on the first day of summer. How'd they do that? Well, all these professors explained it to me, and I'm such an old dud, the old art teacher who just plays with paint, as you saw me do. That's my usual thing. I don't understand it, but some of you are smart enough that you will. Okay, the one for the equinox is the one we're looking at. Okay, I was going to show you this too. I think this, you remember I showed you the picture of the man carrying the backpack? It didn't mean. It's something I made myself, and it can be remade. Y'all see the man walking with the backpack?
Picture.
Yes. Yep. All right, unless I show you this, I'm brainwashing you. It probably isn't a man walking carrying a backpack, but I think it is, and I'm going to take it in. And I hope you like me well enough to believe me. Okay. Now, on the first day of spring, there is a light that comes down on this painting, and that little man is walking up that trail. He's going up the Sunshine Trail in gratitude for this wonderful place that his God has given him to come and enjoy twice a year. This shows twice a year. You'll see how today his feet are not going to be there.
That's amazing, huh?
It is amazing. Now that is a good word, good place to use amazing. And the one for the...
They figured that out, you know.
That they were able to do that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, think about all the things they had. It had to be a committee that agreed. It couldn't be just any old committee. Okay, anyway.
That worked.
Okay, now, what did I forget to tell them, Bill? How the earth turns or something like that? Okay. Do any of you, before we go to the side, do any of you have any questions? Nobody said, when are you going to quit talking? Thank you very much.
Do many other groups come here, all the time or sometime wintertime?
Well, we have, right now my husband is not well, as I told you. And I have quit doing my daily tours, but my wonderful scholarly son comes and does tours on Friday and Saturday. And it's necessary to call for an appointment. But otherwise, and see, since y'all are special, did you know today's not Friday or Saturday? Do y'all feel special? You are very special to us. And I want you to know we are so honored. Do any of you know Juana Patapony?
Juanita Patapony. Juanita Patapony.
Well, Juana is what she has been called.
Okay.
Or dead. Is she still around?
Yes.
She painted the door for me. And I painted one that I grew out in my yard with turtles on it for her. And I hope she kept hers too.
I have a question.
All right.
I noticed on the website it said it may be some LePans also. Do y'all...
There are many, in fact, one scholar, and as I say, Linda's a scholar and Bill's a scholar, and you will find the scholars do not agree on this, but one scholar I listened to, I am not among the scholars, I want you to know that. I'm the art teacher that gets her door banged down by science teachers. But anyway, I want you to know that there was one scientist who had studied a great deal about the nomads in this area, and he said he believed there were as many as 300 different cultures that would have used this campground at one time or another. That doesn't mean they all painted here. It doesn't mean that they came back more than once. But for some reason, he had come up with that. And I know there were a bunch, because I like to look at the difference in the style. And not because of any... What I owe to all the wonderful ideas that I have had is that my grandfather and my uncle got people started after my grandpa came here and saw they were ruining the pictographs. The people who came here who had prejudices against the Native American tribes were scratching on them, shooting at them, and he wanted to preserve them. And he got people interested in coming here and making copies of painting. There was a real well-known man named Forrest Kirkland who came and did probably the most comprehensive job of, was it all, A.T. Jackson was really good too, but A.T. Jackson was not a good artist, and you can't always get the style. But Kirkland was a fine artist, and his book is called Picture, here it is right here. This is, and I think he's, I mean, rock art of Texas Indians. A.T. Jackson was picture writing for rock art. This is, and you can get this in paperback, and it's, just put it in any place. This is a wonderful, wonderful book. But my grandfather and my uncle are the two people who got Forrest Kirkland interested in recording pictographs. And so I feel like my ancestors had the foresight to try to preserve them, and they are so fascinating. After you get started going to see them and reading about them and finding people who know about them, it kind of drives you bananas, and that's why I talk too much to you.
Well, just one quick point.
Okay.
Okay, the people that we believe painted here are people we refer to as humanos, who were a large group of Native Americans who lived from west of San Antonio towards El Paso, then the Lapans. Everybody really didn't like the Apaches, so it was looks like that a lot of the groups, including the Comanches and Wichitas, and probably the Humanos too, kind of ganged up on the Apaches, and the Apaches' dominance here didn't last very long. That's what it looks like. And the Comanches, of course, were here in force from about the end of the 18th century to around the Civil War.
The Comanche were the last ones here, and I would think it would be likely that some of the Comanche paintings are the brightest paintings in there, but we can, you know, you can sit in a circle with people that know about pictographs, and you can just talk forever till that guy comes and knocks the door down and says, you got to go to math class. So, and I hear him knocking. So when you go down there, I'm going to go check and see if my husband has awakened. I tried to get him to take his nap this morning so he'd be able to come up here. And I hope before you leave, he is going to be up. And I'm going to go. The lady that's with him likes these pictographs as much as all of us do. And she'll really be trying to get him to wake up, I know. But anyway, while y'all are down there, I hope that we'll get to come down there and see you. But I'm going to go down and check on him. And Linda and Bill are going to be in charge of you all. And now when you get to the side, if somebody gets real tired of walking, it's going to be hot, you can get...
We'll get them back to the bus.
Yeah, you can get them back to the bus. And I do have... Do y'all have water?
Yeah.
Okay, I have some bottles of water in here if anybody doesn't have one.
We have water.
Yeah. What about you all in your car?
We brought you two cases of water. It's probably
Well, I have a case in here. Okay. I have a nutritionist friend that every time she brings him back in here, she brings a case of water and she says, hydrate, hydrate. Heck, she goes around and makes everybody drink water. So I'll do this for my friend Virginia Adams and tell you, don't forget to drink your water. And y'all have been so attentive. It was a good time for you to rest after that good food from Beefmaster. So, anyway, thank you for coming. You have made my day for sure. Thank you.